What's up, everybody? GenX Dividend Investor here. In this video, I'm going to share a powerful story about investing that may literally save your life or the life of someone you know or love. Then I'm going to respond to a subscriber who is concerned about his future. So in the finance community, we often talk about how awesome it is to invest, and in most situations, I agree. But now I'm going to tell you 10 reasons why you shouldn't buy stocks. Finally, these videos take a lot of time and energy for me to plan, research, and create, so I'd appreciate it if you took a moment to slam that thumbs up button as a simple way you can thank me. So this week I read a very disturbing and heart-wrenching set of tweets by Bill Brewster, who is an analyst that works for Sulamar Capital. I'm going to read these tweets, and I ask that you listen carefully. My cousin-in-law was interested in investing. He opened a Robinhood account, and he seemed to be enjoying the markets. As many of us do, or have done, he got interested in options. He believed he had no margin selected on his account, so he began buying and selling options. Fast forward to sometime this past week and his account showed him owing $700,000. How does a 20-year-old with no income get access to that kind of leverage exposure? The emotional stress from the exposure caused him to take his own life. I don't feel right sharing this, but I also don't feel right keeping it from the world. My heart goes out to the family and friends of that young man. It is absolutely tragic. This was part of a MarketWatch article that made the point that what happened should serve as a reminder that trading stocks can have devastating real-life consequences. I read an article on CNBC that said the trader was 20-year-old Alex Kearns, a sophomore at University of Nebraska at Lincoln. To me, it sounded like Alex felt that Robinhood allowed him to take on too much risk. It wasn't clear if he potentially didn't understand all of the information that Robinhood presented to him. Robinhood has come out and said that they're making a variety of changes to hopefully help prevent something like this from happening again, which is good to hear. There's a reason why I often say that you don't want to invest what you can't afford to lose. There are no guarantees in the market. Let me say that again. There are no guarantees in the market. And please, please don't make the mistake of investing using margin or investing in penny stocks or any of those other get-rich-quick schemes. For those that don't understand margin or leverage, I'll explain. When you buy on margin, it means you are getting an asset, in this case stocks, by borrowing money from a bank or your broker. So buying on margin means you are investing with borrowed money. To me, that is a very bad idea. If you're using margin and your brokerage account falls below a certain level, your broker can sell some or all of your portfolio to get your account back into balance. That sucks and is what a margin call is, which is when you get a call that demands that you invest additional money or stocks into your account so it's brought back up to a certain point. So it's called leverage because using borrowed money can amplify what you're doing, both on the upside and downside, i.e. bigger gains or bigger losses. Now I can't confirm the validity of all the details of that story, but it sounds like he allegedly was trading on margin, or seemingly trading on margin, without realizing it. And then when he thought he was 700k in the hole, it was too much for him to deal with and he killed himself. One thought that occurred to me is that anyone could be struggling with thoughts of suicide for a plethora of reasons. So I wanted to share that there is a national network of local crisis centers that provide free and confidential emotional support to people in suicidal crisis or emotional distress 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, called the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline. I'll include a link to them in my description, along with a 1-800 telephone number that they have on their website, which is suicidepreventionlifeline.org. The number currently is 1-800-273-8255. I recommend checking on their website to see if they've changed any of this info since I have made this video, if you feel you need to follow up. Apparently they have options for the deaf and hard of hearing and chat capabilities online. I also found a story on Business Insider about a day trader who bought hundreds of oil future contracts and interactive brokers allegedly incorrectly showed that he owed $9 million due to a bug in the software that occurred recently when oil futures sunk negative. My understanding is that interactive brokers said that they would rebate their customers who were locked in with a long position during the time the price was negative and any losses they suffered below zero. So the first reason why you shouldn't buy stocks is if you feel you are someone who can't handle the emotional roller coaster that investing often is. Now these are extreme cases I shared which aren't the norm, but when money is on the line, it can change how you feel and act. The number two reason you shouldn't buy stocks is if you are already underwater in debt. I always say that before you invest, you should get rid of your bad debt, like high interest rate credit cards. I normally don't consider mortgages bad debt. The number three reason is if you don't have an emergency fund. Now everyone is in a different financial reality, and you have to determine how big of a cash safety net you need to have, but anywhere from 3 months and up is what I'd recommend. The more risk averse you are, the more your job is shaky, the more people that are reliant on your paycheck, the more months of an emergency fund I would save up. Now don't freak out if you don't have any savings right now, just start committing to saving up. The number four reason why you shouldn't buy stocks is if you need your money for higher priority items. For example, to pay your taxes, to put food on the table, maybe for college, etc. Now be careful with this one because I do believe in paying yourself first, but I also believe that there are certain expenses that you need to budget for and manage. So getting a new Xbox isn't a mandatory expense, but paying your electricity usually is. The number five reason is if you are investing money you can't afford to lose. I always like to ask myself, what if I lost my entire investment? Am I okay? If the answer is no, then don't invest it. Buffett once said, if you are not willing to own a stock for 10 years, do not even think about owning it for 10 minutes. So the takeaway from that quote is don't invest if you're thinking you just want to put your money to work for a few months and then you'll pull it out. The number seven reason you shouldn't buy stocks is if your personality forces you to gamble rather than invest. Or if you're looking to get rich quick. By that I mean if you only want to invest in penny stocks or ridiculously high yield dividends or with risky options or margin, then don't invest at all. Instead, start playing the get rich slowly game. It works. I'm a testament to that. The number eight reason you shouldn't buy stocks is if your mind isn't at a rational place. If you're really scared or confused or whatever, and if you don't feel calm, then don't risk investing. People tend not to make great decisions when they feel stressed, when they aren't at peace. Don't make knee-jerk, stress-induced decisions. There's this great quote by Steve Jobs who said, "Never cut a tree down in the wintertime." That is, never make a negative decision when you are down. Don't make important decisions, like financial ones, when you're in a bad mood. Wait. Be patient. The number nine reason why you shouldn't buy stocks is if you refuse to educate yourself to the market, to stocks, to companies. Don't invest in something because your Uncle Hal recommended it. It's okay to hear their input, then you must take over. Buffett once said, "Your mind is like a bank. What you deposit is what you can withdraw." Do not invest in single stocks if you aren't willing to put in the time to understand them. Instead, I'd consider inexpensive broad market ETFs like VTI or VU. The 10th reason I wouldn't invest in the market is if you aren't able to be patient. If you can't buy quality at a good price and basically leave it alone, if you feel you have to keep buying, selling, trading, and messing with your portfolio, then I'd reconsider if investing is for you. Think of your portfolio like a bar of soap. The more you handle it, the more it tends to shrink. And now I'll give you a bonus reason. Number 11, if you are someone who freaks out at news headlines that aren't fundamentally going to be changing the business you invest in over the long run, then you probably shouldn't be investing in stocks. Okay, let's move on. I got an email which I can't show you because it has a lot of personal information in it, but the gist of it was that the subscriber felt it was too late for them to get into investing. Look, it is never too late. Did you know that 99% of Warren Buffett's wealth came after his 50th birthday? Don't tell me it's too late. It's never too late. I'm in my 40s and I've started a flipping YouTube channel. I didn't even watch YouTube until last year. Maybe you're one of the few people out there who feel they aren't good enough compared to other investors. I saw a stat that said 93% of drivers think that they drive better than the average driver. Think about that for a moment. How can 93% of people be better than the median? That tells me that most people are terrible at assessing themselves relative to others. But investing is about how you are doing, not about how someone else is doing. I found this chart from Richard Bernstein in Bloomberg, which says that normal investors have only averaged around 2% a year in the stock market, while the S&P 500 has averaged between 8 to 9% per year. Why is that? Because people have emotions. They have fear. They chase the crowd. They buy high and sell low. Then sit out as the market comes storming back. I've seen it happen time and time again. Another interesting data point on this chart is that I think it highlights that past returns aren't always indicative of future returns due to changing market dynamics. Case in point, the oil energy sector is leading in this chart, but do you think oil will be giving you the best returns for the next 20 years? The average retail investor only getting 2% or 3% is harsh, but sometimes they can do well. I saw an article on CNBC using data from a firm called RobinTrack, which tracks what people are doing on Robinhood. It found that Robinhood investors increased their total holdings in March, timing things seemingly perfectly right when the market bottomed. That's awesome. But of course, it's only a single instance, so we have to temper our enthusiasm for it until we see a trend of consistently beating the market. Another thing the subscriber mentioned was that they had a lot of baggage in their past. Look, your past is behind you. The only thing that matters is where you go from today, what you do right now. The decisions you make and the actions you take from this moment forward will change your life. You might be going down a bad path. You can change it. You might feel underwater. Seek help and change it. Work hard, move forward. The harder and smarter you are willing to work, the faster you can make progress heading to where you want to be. I believe in you. You can do it. Remember what Teddy Roosevelt said, "Believe you can and you're halfway there." You are infinitely powerful. Don't think you are, know you are. You can overcome the difficulties and challenges that are in front of you. Don't give up. Take action. Work hard. Get help if you need it. Keep moving forward. Tomorrow is a new day. Stay positive. Things can go south fast if you let yourself dwell on negative thoughts and you play that worst case what if game too much. I know, I've been there. I have what you call monkey mind myself. If something really good is going on in my life, I find it hard to sleep because I'm excited. If something really bad is going on, I find myself dwelling on it. Needless to say, I don't sleep much. That's part of the reason why I started dabbling with meditating, which seems to be the ultimate way to stop overly thinking, as part of the goal is simply not to think, which is a lot harder than it sounds. See how long you can sit there and not think about anything. Not even the fact that you're trying not to think about anything. Actually, start thinking about subscribing if you haven't yet, and consider checking out my Patreon page. Speaking of Patreons, I'd first like to call out Dakin YB, who signed up as an aristocrat, which means that he now has access to a private invite-only channel on my Discord, where he helps influence what videos I do, he gets to vote on which thumbnail I use, and he gets to watch my videos before they go out to the general public. I also give priority to chatting with and answering questions from my aristocrats and kings on all my social media platforms, whether it's YouTube, Discord, Instagram, Twitter, or in my podcasts. And it also means that once I release my 2.0 dividend spreadsheet, that he will be able to use it as a service for as long as he remains an aristocrat or king. It has been really exciting for me to get to know Dakin YB, because he worked on my favorite game of all time, EverQuest. How freaking cool is that? He said he used to go driving with Brad McQuaid, the lead designer of EverQuest, who would take out his Ferrari and go zipping around the canyons of California. Freaking awesome. I'd also like to thank Ari, a Patreon king who helped design my thumbnail. Thanks, Ari. It's been fun getting to know you. And today I learned from Ari that some of the best apple pie in the world can be had in Julian, Southern California. I'd like to thank Men8V, who is a Patreon king and who's been my partner in crime as we create my 2.0 spreadsheet. It has been super fun to pair program with him, and I want to say happy anniversary to him and his wife as I'm filming this on June 19th. Men8V is a super kind and smart guy, and I've been having a ball as we tackle this extreme spreadsheeting 2.0 project together. I'd also like to thank my newest Patreon champions, including Blue Ocean, Vader, and Retire With Options. Thank you guys for signing up. Retire With Options just started a YouTube channel a week ago. Awesome. For those that don't know, I run the world's largest free dividend Discord chat server, and the last time I checked we had over 3,300 dividend investors on it, and it's growing all the time. The link's in the description below if you'd like to join. Trust me, you will love it. Thanks, and I'll leave you with this quote from Carol Burnett, who said, "When you have a dream, you've got to grab it and never let go." I am not a financial advisor, and these videos are for entertainment, inspiration, and educational purposes only. Investing of any kind involves risk. I am only sharing my opinion with no guarantee of gains or losses on investments.